The Philippine economy can flourish further if small and medium enterprises remain strong and competitive. Unfortunately, a lot of MSMEs do not have access to capital, while it is equally difficult to obtain a funding boost from bigger banks. Now, ARC Capital Partners is responding to that need through mezzanine financing. Let's now find out what that is from ARC Capital Partners co-founder and managing partner, Abigail Tan, who is now joining us on the Business Roadshow. Welcome to the program, Abigail.
Hi, Stanley. Thank you for having me, and good afternoon to you, Denise, as well as all the viewers.
Good of you to have joined us now, Abigail. ARC Capital Partners, founded in 2014 to address growing financial services needs, specifically by small and medium enterprises. Now, at this stage, most of these businesses relied on traditional banks and financial institutions. Now, you broke ground by offering what's called mezzanine financing to these ventures. Now, tell us, what is mezzanine financing and how does it work?
Sure, happy to share more. So mezzanine financing is actually a hybrid form of capital solution combining both debt and equity. And it's primarily to, in our case, to fund growing businesses for their expansions or acquisitions. So maybe in layman's terms, similar to a building where a mezzanine level is the partial or intermediate floor between, you know, the main floors, our core mezzanine capital offering is meant to be a 3 to 4 year bridge while the company, you know, amass organic cash flows or be able to access bank debt. And how it works is, Stanley, is basically it's an alternative capital solution to a growing SMEs. And it actually is differentiated in three ways. First is an entrepreneur won't necessarily dilute themselves or give up significant control during a hyper growth phase in their business.
Okay.
Secondly, our mezzanine offering essentially are flexible because we at the fundamentally we wanted to actually match the cash flows of the business in terms of their growth. So it is more patient compared to other forms of capital. And lastly, we pride ourselves, Stanley, in providing support beyond finance because we believe that sustainable growth entails transformational change beyond the capital in itself for these SMEs.
All right.
So Abigail, some of these.
Yeah. Yes, please continue.
So some of these support that we do basically is that we instill discipline in routine checkpoints with our investees, improve their governance because this is very important in any subsequent investors or even bank that they will deal with. And lastly, to ensure that there's better financial budgets, forecasts, and reporting that is in place towards a sustainable growth for the business.
And they don't get that kind of support from other financial institutions, I suppose. Now, just to clarify, Abigail, how different is mezzanine financing from the other financing companies like perhaps angel networks or the venture capitalists that also provide some form of help for startups?
Yes, they definitely help the startups, but we are differentiated basically in three ways, Stanley. First is in terms of business life cycle stage. We actually focus on businesses with proven track record and cash flows. So typically these are businesses at expansionary stage with clear growth path. Okay. Secondly, we are also differentiated in terms of size. So we particularly focus on medium-sized businesses and we define these as companies with at least 100 million of annual sales.
Okay.
And because we wanted to deploy at least 50 to 150 million over a 3-year horizon.
Okay, Abigail, now we know for a fact that a lot of businesses, especially the startups or the mom and pops, the simple businesses, they don't want as much intervention. They want more independence as to how the business is run. Now, with this, as you mentioned, you are offering also support and even governance initiatives for these businesses. How receptive are they now to the possibility that creditors like ARC Capital Partners may want shares or even a bigger stake or involvement in a business by being a partner and not just a lender? And what difference does your participation make in a business venture, given all those services, the value added that you mentioned?
Yes. So when we look at every opportunity, Stanley, we always have the entrepreneur in mind and we actually approach them with a private equity lens. So we would often only incorporate the equity element if we see clear equity upsides with the business. Otherwise, our investment, I would say, would be more debt-like. And, you know, we've actually worked with a lot of progressive and like-minded entrepreneurs. And at the end of the day, they are very receptive, especially after seeing our value add, because it will, at the end of the day, always outweighs the cost as part of our investment into the company. I guess at the end of the day, we also wanted to make sure, Stanley, that the entrepreneur still gets the lion's share of the returns of the business even after our investment. That's how we align with them.
Okay, just to get some idea of how this works further, talk to us now about a success story, perhaps, that you're most proud of, perhaps one that indicates that you are on the right path in terms of your mission to help small and medium enterprises. Clean tech, specifically, which was one of your projects as well, which is a sustainable renewable energy company that helps mitigate the effects of climate change. Tell us more about clean tech.
Yes. So, we know that a lot of the utility renewables are basically cornered and invested by conglomerates, if not, you know, prominent families. And we wanted to actually address that opportunity for, you know, good Filipino developers, but may not necessarily have the capital. So I would say Cleantech Global Renewable is one of the examples that we have. When we invested in them in 2018, they were a small developer, but they have actually demonstrated the ability to actually get a project to shovel-ready stage. Unfortunately, during that stage, they didn't have the capital to pursue it forward. That's why they had to sell the project to a foreign investor. So what we did was we actually supported them in their purchase of a 20-megawatt fully contracted facility in Pangasinan.
Okay.
And during that phase, we were able to actually, number one, assist them in terms of you know, opening access to other banks that can provide them with project financing. Secondly, of course, getting the project to a commissioning stage, which actually just happened last year in 2022. So we're very proud of Cleantech because as of today, that particular project already provides electricity to more than 16,000 households in Pangasinan. And that same project actually allowed Cleantech to provide the track record to then venture into joint ventures with Ayala Energy, AC Energy, as well as BlackRock. So this is an example of a company that we've supported 5 years back, but now is able to graduate to the next a larger stage in terms of the investor set that they yielded.
All right, Abigail, you started in 2014. It's 2023 now. You would have been here a decade. How big are you now in terms of capital that you have provided to SMEs? And what is the growth path for our capital partners in the mezzanine capital space?
Yeah, so it's been 6.5 years since we really started this mezzanine strategy. And we've deployed 2 billion pesos so far to 45 SMEs.
2 billion.
When we started this mission to actually address as well as reduce that debt ceiling for small and medium enterprises. And we definitely wanted to do more. So our target is to be able to at least invest in 50 more SMEs over the next 5 years across the Philippines.
Okay, let's take a look at some quick and important numbers now about SMEs and financing in the Philippines to illustrate, in fact, the dearth in terms of financing options for these new small businesses. Now, in a 2020 study, your study, in fact, saying 99.5% of all enterprises in the Philippines are considered SMEs. And also a fact that 5.7% of these businesses were served by banks, which are providing capital to bigger corporates for the most part. Now, government data also showing there are about 4,800 medium enterprises in 2020. Now, Abigail, if ARC serves even just 1 to 2% of this very big base, how much capitalization and growth potential are we looking at?
Yeah, so if we just, you know, be able to pick from the haystack at 2%, that in each of them would require about 50 million pesos. That's already equivalent to about 4.8 billion for us to serve. And hopefully with, you know, with them getting to know more about us, we're able to deploy this faster, thereby allowing them to then graduate to a medium or a large type of company in the Philippines.
All right, moving forward, many businesses now, because of this kind of environment where you are living in a high interest rate environment, if you go by banks and other financial institutions to borrow capital, SMEs are reluctant about expansions at this stage. because of the high borrowing costs from the traditional channels and general economic conditions, of course, are very challenging, and a lot of them are even putting off expansions. Now, what edge can they attain if they come to you?
I think ultimately, Stanley, the edge is really in our capital's DNA and our commitment to provide support beyond finance to our investee partners, because we believe that sustainable growth doesn't only require capital, but it really requires transformational change in the company. It's very fundamental. Mm-hmm. And from our partners' point of view, or prospective partners' point of view, they can expect us to provide the support through providing them, you know, business plan as well as financial forecasting exercises, our network as well, that enable us to do some business development activities, and ultimately, you know, as a financial advisor, partner, and sounding board as they grow their business to the next stage of their life cycle.
All right. These are still difficult times, of course. We even see a lot of corporates holding off on expansions. IPOs, we're not meeting those IPO targets as far as the Philippine stock market is concerned. Really, is this a good time to get into business and borrow money, Abigail?
Yeah, I would qualify that. So I think if, you know, an entrepreneur has demonstrated traction with clear, visible expansion plans, whether it's organic or inorganic, their margins and turns are largely tested, we believe it is value accretive for an entrepreneur to actually borrow, especially if they have capital constraints. And I think we believe in the saying that, you know, time is money and opportunities are priceless. So we don't see any reason why an entrepreneur should not borrow if a growth is visible ahead of them, because that ultimately brings value to their business.
Lastly, of course, to those who want to know more about mezzanine financing and ARC Partners, how do they reach you? Is there a website they can check?
Yes, they can actually learn more about us at www.arccapital.com. So arqcapital.com.
All right, on that note, thank you so much for being with us on the show today, Abigail Tan, ARC co-founder and managing partner. Have a good day.
Thank you, Stanley. Have a good day. Bye.
Bye.